These next two slides show the objectives for this module. Before we begin, let's review some definitions you may recall from the very first module. Solution. Solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances having the same composition throughout. A solvent is the substance in a solution that dissolves the other substances. This is usually the major component of a solution. Water, H2O, is sometimes called the universal solvent because it dissolves more substances than any other liquid. Plus, it's cheap and it's plentiful. We love water as a solvent here at SRS. Solute. Solute is a substance in a solution that's dissolved into the solvent. So it's usually the minor component in a solution. Now here's a solution everyone should be familiar with. It's simply salt and water, otherwise known as a saline solution. It's what the world's oceans are made out of. You have your solvent, in this case water, the dissolving medium, the major component, and you have the solute, which is salt, that's the substance being dissolved, that's the minor component. And add those two together, you get a solution, a homogeneous mixture. Now, so far we've only talked about one type of solution, that's solid and liquid, that's your salt water. But there are other types of solutions as well. You have gas and gas, the most common example being air, the air we breathe. It's a solution of nitrogen, argon, oxygen, and other trace gases. You have gas and liquid. That's like your carbonated drinks. Gas and solid. This is very rare. H2 and palladium metal. Liquid and liquid. You have gasoline, beer. Liquid and solid. That's mercury and dental fillings. In this case, the liquid would be the minor component, the liquid mercury, and the solid dental filling will be the major component. And seawater, of course, solid and liquid, and solid and solid. That's your metal alloys like sterling silver. Here's another definition you need to know. Solubility. Solubility is defined as the maximum amount of a substance that can be dissolved in a specific amount of solvent at a specified temperature and pressure. And that sounds like a lot, but what this means is it's just how easy a substance goes into solution and is maintained in solution in a specific solvent. Now let's look at some factors affecting solubility. First of all, the chemical and physical properties of the solute and solvent. All this means is some things just don't mix, like we know oil and water don't mix. Also, if you take salt and try to put it on an ice cube, it doesn't mix as well as salt and water. Two other factors affecting solubility are temperature and pressure. Now let's talk about temperature first. Now we're all familiar with tea. We have hot tea and we have cold tea. And we all know that sugar dissolves easier in hot tea than cold tea. Why is that? Well, the chemistry explanation is because molecules in the hot liquid tea are moving faster, causing more collisions with the sugar molecules. And this is also true of a liquid dissolving in any other liquid. In this experiment, watch how much faster the dye dissolves in the hot water than it does in the cold water. Now you take gases and liquid, gases will be less soluble at a higher temperature. Now why is this? Well, because gas molecules, when they get warmer, they start moving faster and they can escape from the liquid a lot easier. Think of a soda. All right, when it gets hot, what happens? It gets flat. That's because all the carbon dioxide molecules have escaped. So while we're talking about carbonated beverages, let's talk about the effect of pressure on solubility. Now, pressure has no effect on the solubility of solids and liquids or liquids and liquids, but pressure has a significant effect on the solubility of gases and liquids. Now, let's go back to our example of a carbonated beverage. Now, we know that when we crack the top of a carbonated beverage open, what happens? Well, if it's a clear bottle, we see bubbles start to rise up as we turn the cap, and then we hear that psst sound. What is that? Well, recall that a carbonated beverage is a solution of a gas, carbon dioxide, and a liquid, and it's under very high pressure. That's to keep the CO2 gas in the liquid. Now, this pressure is higher than atmospheric pressure, so that when you break the seal or open the cap, the pressure decreases, and the CO2 bubbles have a chance to escape. And if you leave it open long enough, eventually they will all escape, especially if the beverage gets warm, and it will be flat. Remember what we said about temperature's effect on the solubility of gases and liquids. So, what does that tell us about the effect of pressure on the solubility of gases and liquids? Well, the higher the pressure, the better the gas stays in solution. So, high pressure, high solubility. Low pressure, low solubility. This table summarizes what we've just learned about the effects of temperature and pressure on solubility. Now we're going to talk about the concept of saturation, and this only applies to solid and to liquid solutions like salt and water, sugar and water, and so forth. The definition of a saturated solution is a solution that contains the maximum amount of dissolved solute. An unsaturated solution, on the other hand, contains less than the maximum amount of dissolved solute under the same conditions. Now, it's very important that we stipulate under the same conditions, because as we learned earlier, solids such as sugar dissolve faster if the liquid solvent is heated up. So we're saying if you take a specific amount of water at a specific temperature, you can measure how much sugar you can completely dissolve in that amount of water. In other words, the maximum amount of sugar that amount of water will hold. How will you know what that amount is? That is the saturation point of the water. Well, when you start to see undissolved sugar at the bottom of the container, you know that this is now a saturated solution. So as long as you don't see sugar or solute granules at the bottom of the container during the dissolving process, you know you can dissolve more. So you have an unsaturated solution. It contains less than a maximum amount of dissolved solute. Again, we can change the conditions so more sugar can be dissolved, and we'll talk about that next. So, we can change the conditions to force more solute to dissolve by creating a supersaturated solution. A supersaturated solution is a solution that contains more dissolved solute than a saturated solution under the same conditions. We can create a supersaturated solution by heating the solution, dissolving more solute, then slowly cooling it. Thank you. That was the introduction. Now we're about to get into the heart of this module on solutions, starting with the concept of concentration. Now, concentration is a measurement of the amount of solute present in a given amount of solution. Now remember, a solution contains a solute, the minor component, and a solvent, the bigger or major component. This is a very important concept to keep in mind as we do these calculations. A concentrated solution is one that contains a relatively large amount of solute as compared to the amount of solvent. A dilute solution is one with a relatively small amount of solute as compared to the amount of solvent. Note the word relatively. So there's no set amount of solute that determines whether a solution is concentrated or dilute. It all depends on what you started with and what you end with. Hopefully, this will become clearer to you later. So how do we make things more concentrated or more diluted? The concentration process involves adding more solute. Think of adding more sugar to your tea to make it sweeter, or you can take away some of the solvent, the liquid. Now, this can be done by boiling the liquid, which is what they do in the tank farms and the evaporation systems. You could also make a solution more concentrated by adding a more concentrated solution to the dilute solution. Now, the dilution process involves, of course, adding more liquid or solvent, or decreasing the solute, or adding a more dilute solution to the concentrated solution. So we need a way to quantitatively measure concentration. In other words, put a number on it. So there are a number of different ways of expressing solute concentration that are commonly used. Let's go back to our objectives. Now, these are commonly used concentration units, and you may possibly see some or all of these in your facility on chemical labels or on sample results. And notice that the objective only requires you to define A through F. Now, this next objective, however, says you need to do calculations involving C, D, and E. That's parts per million, parts per billion, and weight percent. So that's where we'll spend the majority of our time. So for the rest of these units, you don't need to do any calculations, just to know what they are and be able to identify them as units of concentration. So let's begin with molarity. This is moles of solute per liter of solution. In this formula, the amount of solute is always expressed in moles, and the amount of solution, that is the solute, plus the solvent, is always expressed in liters. So molarity is designated by a capital M. So a solution with a concentration of 1 mole per liter is a 1 molar, or 1 capital M solution. So here's an example of how this is calculated. Again, you don't have to perform molarity calculations in this course, but this is just to give you a better understanding of the concept of molarity. So say I want to make a 0.5 or half a molar solution of sodium hydroxide or caustic. First, I need to calculate how many grams are in 1 mole of sodium hydroxide so I can measure it out. And we've covered this a while back. All you need to do is go to your periodic table and add up the gram atomic weights of sodium, which is about 23 grams, oxygen, which is about 16 grams, and hydrogen, which is about 1 gram. This gives you about 40 grams, which is the weight in grams of 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. So to get 0.5 moles, simply multiply that 40 by 0.5 or divide by 2. They'll give you 20 grams. So now all you have to do is measure out 20 grams of sodium hydroxide and mix it with enough solvent, usually water, to give you 1 liter of solution. And this will give you a 0.5 molar solution of sodium hydroxide. Normality is another way of expressing concentration, although not as common or straightforward as some of the others. Here's a short video that explains the basics, but again, you won't have to perform calculations using normality. You just need to be familiar with the term and recognize it as a unit of concentration. Mole percent is another unit of concentration, and with this we can get the mole percent of the solute or the mole percent of the solvent, depending on what we want. Now usually we're looking for the mole percent of the solute, so we take the moles of solute and divide by the total of the moles of solute and solvent, then multiply by 100. So we add the solute and solvent together in the denominator. As you can see, if we want the mole percent of the solvent, we just put the moles of solvent on top in the numerator. Here's an example problem using mole percent. Should be pretty straightforward. Just remember, you won't be required to do any molarity, normality, or mole percent calculations in this course. These examples are just to give you a better understanding of these concentration units. Parts per million ppm and parts per billion ppb are commonly used terms to describe the concentration of contaminants or impurities in naturally occurring materials such as air, water, and soil. Now, one part per million means one part contaminant for every million parts of soil or air or water. So these units are used when the expected concentrations of contaminants should be very, very small. Like the sample results from water that is released from SRS into the environment from ETP. So, parts per million is the number of parts of solute per 1 million parts of total solution, and parts per billion is the number of parts of solute per billion parts of solution. As I said earlier, you will be required to perform ppm and ppb calculations in this course. The best advice I can give you in working these problems, in all problems, is practice, practice, practice. Study the examples given in this module, and then work the worksheet problems that are provided by your instructor. So, now we'll talk about the formulas. And there are two formulas each for ppm and ppb, and you will have to memorize these formulas because they are not provided in the exam reference guide. Again, the more you practice, the more they'll become ingrained in your head. Here are the first two. Please write them down. For these, notice the units don't matter, but they must be the same for solute and solvent. And here are the next two. Again, write these down. For these, you have to convert the amount of solute or the minor component to milligrams for ppm. And to micrograms for ppb. So remember, milligrams is 1/1000th of a gram, and micrograms is 1/1000000th of a gram. So you have to remember how to do the conversions. So here's a ppm example. What is the concentration in ppm if 0.8 grams of calcium chloride is dissolved in 250 milliliters of water? Note, 1 gram equals 1 milliliter. That's a very important note. So we have two formulas we can use. Which one do we use? Well, you look at the first one. It says amount of solute over amount of solution times 10 to the 6. And notice in this one, the units must be the same. Well, look at that note. 1 gram equals 1 milliliter. So we have 0.8 grams of calcium chloride, which we can convert to 0.8 milliliters, dissolved in 250 milliliters of water. So already, both units are the same. So this would be the easiest formula to use in this case. So here's the solution. Well, the first thing I want you to notice is that in this problem, the solute and the solvent are given separately. And the formula requires the amount of solution. Remember what we said earlier, solution is solute plus solvent. So you have to add the 250 plus the 0.8 to get the amount of solution. Now, it may not be that significant this time. It may not make that big a difference in the solution to this problem, but in the future it will, so you have to remember that. Also notice here your units, your milliliters, are going to cancel out. And this happens in all your parts per billion problems. Here's an example using parts per billion. Another point, make sure you read the problem and make sure you know what they're asking for, whether it be parts per million or parts per billion, before you start calculating. And here's a solution. Speaking of solution, notice in this problem, you were given a 5,090 gram solution. So you did not have to add the solute and solvent. Now we're going to talk about another concentration unit, weight percent. Weight percent is similar to parts per million, parts per billion. In fact, you can think of it as parts per hundred. Weight percent is simply the mass of the solute divided by the mass of the solution times 100. Note that the units must be the same for the solute and solution for this formula to work. Here's an example using weight percent. See if you can work through this one on your own. Now, if you got 9.11%, you're wrong. You didn't add the solute and the solvent together to get the solution. Remember to do that. As an operator, you may need to change the concentration of a solution by either adding a quantity of a different concentration or adding more solvent, that is, diluting it. Now, the batch chemical concentration formula can be used for making a batch of solution with the desired concentration, for adjusting the concentration of the solution, and for mixing batches of solutions of known concentration and predicting what the new concentration will be. When using this equation, any units of chemical concentration or volume may be used. However, the units must be the same, all of the concentration values. That is, concentration initial, concentration added, and concentration final. And all the units must be the same for all the volume values. That's initial volume, added volume, and final volume. If concentration initial is in units of parts per billion and concentration added is in units of parts per million, either unit may be used. However, one unit will have to be converted to the other. Now, this formula may look rather imposing, but not to worry. This equation is provided on your exam reference sheet, so there's no need to memorize them. So, refer to the example in the study guide as I walk you through it. First thing we should do when attacking these problems, before we put pencil to paper, is to analyze the problem. Know what is going on, know what is given, know what is being asked for, and if possible, try to predict what range of values the correct answer should be. Draw a picture if you have to. In this problem, we start out with 3 liters of a 25 parts per million solution, and we want to add 1 liter of a 1 parts per million solution to it. So, do we expect this new solution to be more concentrated or more dilute? In other words, would the concentration of this new solution be greater than, less than, or equal to 25 parts per million, the initial concentration? Well, obviously, if you're adding a significantly lower concentration solution to your original solution, you would expect the concentration to decrease. But since you're only adding a relatively small amount, only 1 liter to the 3 liter solution, the concentration should decrease, but only slightly. Let's see if our theory is correct. So let's fill in the variables. The problem asks for the new or final concentration, so CF is unknown, so we'll call it X. The final volume will be what you had, 3 liters, plus what you add, 1 liter, a total of 4 liters. Initial concentration is given as 25 parts per million. Initial volume is 3 liters. Added concentration is given as 1 parts per million, and added volume is 1 liter. So we see all of the concentrations are consistent, same units, and all of the volumes are also consistent, same units. So let's go ahead and plug in the values and do the math. So in your study guide, they first manipulate the equation to solve for the unknown, but you don't have to do this. So as you can see, we came up with 19 parts per million, which is slightly less than our original 25 parts per million, as we predicted. So here's your batch chemical dilution formula. Notice it's missing CAVA. That's because your added concentration is going to be zero since you're diluting it. You're only going to be adding solvent.